I have done a foolish thing. I have prepared a sermon that's this thing. It was the nature of the week. And where I was going is priestly provocation. Well, I don't want to provoke you, do I? You don't come to church to be provoked. But in fact, the text says that we are called to provoke one another. I don't know if you heard that buried in Hebrew. We're called to provoke one another and to goodness and love. I have decided since 8 o'clock to now that I'm doing this over 2 weeks. There's just too much material. What I want to do is maybe move a little slowly and explain something. Today is going to be more of a teaching sermon to explain some things, hopefully to equip you. Now, some of you are been asked to do what we have called the NCD, which is the Natural Church Development. And I've touched on it maybe a little bit next week as well, about how to grow a healthy church or certain components. And so people are asked to fill out a survey. If you've been asked to fill out a survey coming up, please put up your hand and leave it up. See, are people here in this congregation, thank you very much, who are going to be filling out a survey next Sunday? Right? Next time. And we filled out a first survey, I don't know, 9 months ago, a long time ago. And the one piece that we felt that we were weakest in, the area that we kind of limped into, is we all felt that we were growing in our faith and understanding the faith more, but we were feeling like didn't know how to give it away, didn't know how to share it. And therefore, much of my sermons over the last 9 months, whether you know it or not, have been trying to equip you on how to share the faith. Now, in order to share the faith, it implies that you know the faith, that you know your stuff, so that you are prepared in and out of season to give away that faith. That's in Peter's epistle, by the way, from Peter 3, that we are ready in and out of season, ready if someone asks, can you explain why you have the hope that is within you? Today's sermon, I'm hoping, is going to be able to explain the pivot key piece of our faith that has been held by Christians for centuries. And it is a core piece. And it comes from the letter to the Hebrews. Now, I have not been preaching on Hebrews per se over the last number of weeks, but the lectionary tells me I don't get to just pick any lesson I want. They're chosen, and that's our Anglican way, so that you end up hearing the full gospel. Well, today is probably one of the heaviest, most profound, thickest lessons there is in Scripture, and I feel obliged to try to unpack it for you. But I believe that I have, for all the theology, I've got two really practical points for you to take away, okay? So that you will be able to walk out of here and go, but today I'm going to touch on one of them, and next week I'm going to do the second one. So you want more, you've got to come back with the second one. I believe that all this theology is hugely practical. I was listening to Phyllis Tickle on Friday. How old is Phyllis Tickle? She's about 80 years old. And she had us in the palm of her hand in here all day from 9 to 3 o'clock. And that woman puts me to absolute shame of her intellectual prowess, spiritual depth, compassion for the church, and knows her stuff. She got to the point, she said, everybody who seeks ordination in the church must first get a degree in physics if you want to do ministry in the future. Because the world of physics and the world of the faith are actually coming together, and you need to be able to express it. I, at that point, emotionally closed down. I could dabble with quantum for all of about 2 minutes, and then I've exhausted my knowledge. But what I'm going to share with you today is every bit as important as quantum physics, because it applies, and we need to know that part of the story. Now, 3 weeks ago, it was All Saints Day, and we celebrated late on late October, and I was walking around, and I took, who was here for that might remember, and I took stoles, and I put stoles on people. And I was indicating to you that we have a priesthood of all believers. It's a biblical image. It is essence of the Protestant Reformation. It's essential that, and it was the Protestants who were rejecting the Roman Catholic notion of such a top-down church model and saying, hey, the Bible says that we're all priests and we all have ministry. So that's good. Some are called to be prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists for the work of the ministry to equip the saints. That's going on in Ephesians 4, and I touched on it. But it begs the question that you know what a priest is. Do you know, can you rattle off quickly what a priest is? You call me a priest of the church. When we talk about someone who's a doctor, we have to understand, well, this person might be a pediatrician, this is an orthopod, this is an ENT specialist. There are different types of doctors. There's a language in the medical world that people kind of understand, it's a little more nuanced. A lawyer isn't just a lawyer. The lawyer might be a barrister and the lawyer might be a solicitor. Those are two different roles, but they're both called lawyers. What is a priest? You need to be able to express and answer that. And in order to understand what a priest is to understand certainly the Old Testament notion of a priest, the Jewish tradition. Thus the letter to the Hebrews. It's an explanation. It's a letter written to the Jewish community, the Hebrews. And it's saying, we're going to explain to you why Jesus matters. Why? What is it that Jesus is doing? And you all need to know that as Christians, if you're going to be out in the world, why is this Jesus so different than Buddha, Muhammad, etc.? Okay? There are differences. Many of the world religions have much in common. Fair enough. But this Christianity does separate and hold separately, and it fits, its pivotal is Hebrews 10, 9 and 10 in particular. That's page 174 in your Pew Bible that's right in front of you. So if you want to take a look and daydream while I'm preaching, that would be a good place to daydream. It's page 174 in the New Testament section of your Bible. Oh, nobody daydreams. So I'm going to give you some theory, but there's a huge practical application coming up. So, and if you don't listen to the first part of the practical application, you'll be lost on it. Because what I'm about to tell you has changed my life. So this isn't just theology, it's really theology that has practical peace to it. And I pray to you as well. A priest, now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put into my words what's going on in Hebrews 9 and 10. Verses chapter 10, verses 1 and following in particular. It's going to be my language, not as precise as the Bible, but it should be clear. First thing a priest does is pray and intercede for others. So in the old Anglican world, how many of you remember the old Anglican world, where the altar, the holy table, would a Protestant say, a Catholic says an altar, Anglicans say both, because we like to confuse people. This holy table is up against that east wall. It was Garnsworthy who moved it down. He moved it down to great turmoil in this church. The altar in the chapel, the holy table, is against the wall. That's coming from a model that says, God is up there, I'm the priest, and I stand between the people and God. And I remember when the priest would celebrate with his back to the people, and it was only a he, and so there went up. Okay. So what we're saying is that God is there, but the priest's job is to intercede and stand in between. In the ancient patristic church, it was none of that nonsense. The altar was correctly here, among the people. Are a circle that we're around in the presence of God is in our midst. I like that image a whole lot better. And and therefore I supported Garnsworthy's move to move the altar down, even though I wasn't even thought of when he was doing it. But anyway, it came down, and the only thing he did wrong is he didn't move it far enough, but we'll deal with that later. The priest intercedes. Do any of you believe that I actually stand between you and God? No. Okay? So that means you've bought something really important. A Protestant emphasis is that the priesthood has in fact been abolished. Jesus abolishes the priesthood. How do I know that? It's explained clearly in Hebrews 10, verse 9, that the old way is now abolished and the new has come. The priest in the Old Testament would come, and year after year, the priest stands and offers sheep, goats, blood, etc., that whole purification rite. And Yom Kippur would be the Feast of the Atonement, once a year primarily. But it, as Scripture says, it was repeated over and over and over every year. Because we know that this man and this church building is hopefully a replica, but it's only a replica of what the real divine is. Right? Real heaven as opposed to what we're doing here. When Jesus comes, he dies on that cross. He's God incarnate. He is the Lamb of God. It's there in Hebrews 10:10. Is that when he dies, he pays for the price once and for all. How many of you know your old Book of Common Prayer? In the old Book of Common Prayer, only three hands went up. How many know your old Book of Common Prayer? Some of you, okay, good. The priest does the priestly prayer, and he says in the middle of the prayer of consecration, and Jesus was one perfect satisfaction, oblation, for the sins of the whole world. Offered how many times? Once. It's been done. It's been paid for. It is finished. Christ's death on the cross. Therefore, the priesthood has now been abolished. Jesus is the priest. Jesus is the one who intercedes on our behalf. That's what the priest does. And if you are now a priest in Christ, you are called to intercede on behalf of others. So let alone have your own ministry. Simply put, we are all called to intercede for someone. When Helena was sick, Lynn, and you were struggling in that walk, as we all were, you didn't have the energy to pray. Because you were so focused. That's what happens to people. Sort of picking on you, Len. Just came to heart. But here's, no pun intended, came to heart, Len Hart. And so, the piece is that the priest comes and intercedes for you. Let me pray for you. Let the church pray for you. Today, Stephen Monk is going to do prayers and he's going to offer up names and intercede. We are called not just to pray about me and I want a new car. Please help me get a job, as important as that is, our own personal agenda, we intercede on behalf of others. That's your priestly action. And that's what Jesus is doing. This has been, therefore, at the time of the Reformation, you would never call me a priest. That's why I don't go by Father Drew. It's too priestly in the language, even though you would call me a priest. How many of you, in your earlier days here at St. John's, would never have called O'Neill or McCollum, my predecessors, a long time ago, you would not have called them Father O'Neill, right? There's no notion of priest there. He's the minister. Why is he the minister? Because Jesus is the priest, not this guy. Really important. Jesus is the one who intercedes. That's why we are so Jesus-centered. That's why the cross is all important. When a minister comes to a new church, we are told always to do nothing in the first year. You listen and watch and live with the people. Okay? I did my best to do that for at least 10 months. You're all laughing at me. It lasted a week or two. The first thing I did before I walked into my office, not a word of a lie, not an ounce of exaggeration, first thing I did when I came into this church, before walking into my office, is I walked straight up here and I removed the wooden altar rail right here. I just took it out and then I hid it. I don't even know if Bill knows where it is. That's how hidden it is. Right? Why would I do that? Because this is a barrier. This is the old school. This is the Holy of Holies. This isn't. This is. What is that? Not true. In Christ, you are all welcome at this holy table. The priesthood has been abolished. Christ has died once for all. There were Anglican clerics who were martyred and burned at the stake because their consecration prayer said Jesus died once for all. It's really important that we know this. In the Roman tradition, with the doctrine of transubstantiation, I'm not trying to be critical, I'm just putting facts out there, is that the priest celebrates the Mass, and every time he celebrates the Mass, Jesus is re-crucified. That is the teaching of Rome. We do not teach that here. We teach that Christ's sufficient oblation, satisfaction for the sins of the whole world happened 2,000 years ago, and it lasts and rests on that once for all. It's Hebrews 10:10. It's right there in your scripture. That's where we got it. Now, that's all well and fine. So what? So what is it changes how I live in this world. That I know that the sins of the world have been atoned for. How that atonement happens is a whole other piece, and we can discuss the doctrine of atonement some other day. I'm not going to get into that one, but I am going to say that in Christ, the sins of the world are forgiven. And then when you confess your sins, God takes that and you are washed clean. That's why we celebrate Eucharist 9 out of 10 Sundays. I mean, that's what we do. We gather around the table. So I am not a priest on the one hand. On the other hand, you do call me priest. So why do you call me priest? Why? Why do we? You look at the back of the prayer book, it's bishop, priest, and deacon. Why is it priest? I just give you all the reasons why it's not a priest. That's why there's a Presbyterian church. They are presbyters. And they call their ministers ministers. They don't call them father. They don't call them priest. And the difference is, so I made it clear, I'm not a priest. In the next breath, I am. Why? Because I, what's that? Anyone want to answer? Because every week, I get your eyes focused on that table. On Jesus' priestly action. Jesus is Lord. Jesus is King. He is teacher. He is role model. Jesus is a bunch of stuff. He's Lord. Guess what? He's high priest. And when we enter into that priestly understanding, that's why we don't do morning prayer all the time. Because the chief action of sermons come and go, God knows, huh? But I'll tell you that communion is there for good. And you come and you gather around the table and you are reminded that he is the propitiation for the sins of the world. That's good news. In verse 17, someone read out loud to me, verse 17, please. Just, what does it say?
Verse 17, just one of the lights of the prayer. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more.
I will remember their sins no more. That line changed my life. That line allowed me to walk out into the world with a sense of, not only is this true that in Christ I am, my sins are atoned for, I get to enter into the Holy of Holies, the Jewish image, but now my sins are forgotten. That God has washed them away. I'm hoping this is actually a comfort to you, not a provocation, but I put this to you. Next week there'll be more slides and you'll see different pictures. Here's the piece. Even priests don't get this. So I leave you with this story. It's a true story of a priest in the Philippines. He's kind of tired, kind of cynical, working hard. He's got a parishioner, and that parishioner has visions, especially in her dream life. And when she shares those visions, they come true. So she gets to the point where she starts to say, I have had a vision from God. And the priest says to her, oh, give me a break. That's the priest speaks in. So he says to her, he says, so, in my past, I have a sin that I have carried a long time. It's a burden. Back in my days when I was in seminary, I crossed the line, whatever that line is. I don't know what the sin is. It doesn't matter what it is. We all got our own sin, huh? Right? Let's not pick on the priest. We all got our story. The thing that we're carrying from way back when. Forgive me, Lord, for the sins of my youth. Psalm 25. Okay? We all got our thing. The priest is saying, I got a burden and I can't let it go. And he's carrying this. He then says to this woman in his parish and says, cynically, so if you talk to God one day, why don't you just ask God, what was my sin back in seminary? If you can tell me that, then I'll believe you. Next day, he sees the woman and he says, so by the way, were you talking to God? And she said, actually I was. Did you ask God about what my sin was back in seminary? She said, yeah, I did. And did he tell you? She said, no. Why? Because God said, I forgot it. Do you get that? I forgot it. That God has forgotten your indiscretion, your sin. When he cleanses you, he not only forgives you, he lets it go. And it's behind him. And that allows me to walk into the future because my background, all of our background, is a certain train wreck from time to time, huh? And I go, but Lord, you forgave me, and now I can look forward and move into the future with a release. Here's my problem, pastorally, and I've been wrapping the sermon up here. It's meant to be a comfort to you, but my concern is so many people come to church and they offer their sins to God and they feel they're forgiven and then they walk out and then they pick them up again and they carry them. And there's a burden there. And Jesus is saying to you, it is finished. It is paid for. It is done. It is forgotten. Now go live in the world free as my children. And when you own that truth, personally, I guarantee you, the sky will be bluer and the sun will be brighter and the world will look better for you and you will have a more effective ministry out in the world. So be a priest, a priesthood of all believers. And know that you are forgiven. In Jesus' name, amen.